the class that he was my professor was my capstone class. And it was the only time, I think, in UNLV history that the capstone class was done in the first session of summer school. So 3 weeks. We were together Monday through Friday from like 8 to 4 p.m. So I think, you know, 8 hours a day, 3 weeks straight, you know, we're going to get to know each other pretty well. So I'll tell you, I have some slides, and I kind of ramble, and you guys are welcome to keep me honest and point me back on track. If I get off of it, I'll tell you a little bit about what I do at the Cosmopolitan. I'm happy to answer any questions afterwards. I agree with everything that you heard. The slides that we just saw are very academic. I obviously we're back in school. This is because we're on campus. My slides are going to be a little bit more, how do we put what we just heard into action in my daily world? So I've been at the Cosmopolitan for 8 years. I started there a year before we opened and have kind of seen it through. I had young children at the time, and I kind of consider the Cosmopolitan as my third child in a lot of ways. I'm super protective about it. If you say Cosmo when you ask me a question, I will correct you. What is it, Shivangi? It's the Cosmopolitan, right? Yeah. All right, so there's a lot of words on this slide, but if you think about everything that we just saw on the slides, unconstrained demand, optimal mix, trying to deliver a target mix and maximize revenue, it's very much like Dr. Shoemaker just talked about. So our approach in revenue management at Cosmopolitan, and it really shouldn't be too different up and down the strip, is to leverage our hotel inventory, which is our most precious asset. If we don't sell it tonight, it's gone tomorrow, you lost the opportunity to make money. And our goal, obviously, is to maximize earnings. And so we do that through three strategies. Some of you work for the competition in here, I know. So don't try to steal all this. I'm looking in that last second to the last. So we have a revenue management system that we use that helps us be really smart about creating a forecast and running an optimization cycle. I fully admit that I almost failed high school math. That is a true story. And so I deal with numbers a lot during the day, but I have a lot of systems that help me do that, and I actually am better in math today than I was in high school. But if you look at all those things in that first column, this process of revenue management, so we take all of this into consideration as we're thinking about pricing. We look at historical demand trends. We look at weekday and weekend, and we'll see that on a future slide. We look at seasonality, holidays and events. We look at citywide conventions, what's happening in the market. We look at what our competition is doing. Setting the optimal mix is really important. So at the Cosmopolitan, we do about 50% of our rooms on an annual basis are transient. Transient are people just like you and I, we're not attached to a convention. We're not here part of a casino offer. Group standpoint, we do about 30% of our group rooms on an annual basis, and 20% of our rooms are casino. And the way that we evaluate casino business is not truly just on the ADR that they're bringing to the table. And ADR, anybody know what it means? Sorry if I do acronyms that you don't know. Average daily rate, right? So for a cash customer, for a transient customer, they're going to give us a cash rate. And they're also going to spend a little bit of money on the hotel premise. We hope that we're taking the right customers so that they're dining with us and not walking over the bridge to, you know, the Miracle Mile for dinner. What we see that happens with seasonality, and I'll show you a slide next. In the summer, when I have to sell more transient rooms because it's a season when group is down a little bit, we have to lower our rate to get more transient business. The problem with that is that the customers that come in at a lower rate, they make me cringe a little bit. They typically travel with their own cooler, so we have a nickname for them. Anybody want to guess?
Coleman family.
The Coleman family, how did you know? Do you work in a hotel? You have Colemans too? Or are you a Coleman?
I'm a Coleman.
Well, you are not welcome, but okay. I'm just kidding. We'll take your money. And really, I joke, but I don't joke. We don't want you coming in and checking in with a cooler full of your own shit. Stop. I want you to go to our bar and buy our beer, or have a lunch at Cina Poblano and then go to STK for dinner, but not travel with like your little Lunchable pack, because I'm sure that's what's in your cooler. And then from a, and then if we look at that last box, we're ultimately creating this target mix. And if we've done everything right and understand our demand and how we should price, then this is the outcome. So we can adjust levers, we can pull with pricing, we can decide to take corporate business, we can decide to take a meeting versus not a meeting. I actually just left my boss's office earlier today and we've got a big problem on our hands. You know, March Madness, just last week, anybody excited? Anybody's bracket still alive? Do you guys have brackets? Mr. Coleman, you have a bracket?
No, I don't.
My bracket is still alive. I have Kansas winning it all, but there are a lot of people's brackets that are busted. And so March Madness is a really big time for the Cosmopolitan. We did amazing for 4 days, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And we have this big event in our ballroom. And 3 years ago, when we were deciding on taking a piece of group business in March of 2019, so it would have been, you know, 6 years away, we were holding our Hoops and Hops event in a different space. And so we've migrated into this bigger ballroom now, and so we looked ahead to March of 2019 because the tournament's behind us and we're starting to plan for next year's party, and we say, oh my goodness, we've got a group who is coming in over March Madness and they have that ballroom. That's not making some people really happy on property right now. So that's going to be the first thing that I have to tackle tomorrow when I get to work. But we'll have to pull some levers and then we'll have to get ourselves out of that. Okay, I should have already gone to the slide. So seasonality. So this is what I was talking about. So if you look at the colors along the bottom, so group is blue, transient squiggle line is green, and then casino is that red line. And so casino is pretty stable for us at the Cosmopolitan throughout the year. But you can see how transient and group have an inverse relationship in those summer months. And so when group is down, and you think about it, a meeting planner is not going to get 1,000 delegates from any type of industry to want to be excited about coming to Las Vegas in July. It's just really hot, and it's probably not where they want to be. And so that's when we have to trade that business for transient business. Our ADR goes down a little bit. Ultimately, our RevPAR a little bit down. The big bars on every month are RevPARs. And so you can see what happens. I've got some comments up here in terms of late winter, summer, fall, and winter. For us, we know what our busiest months are for convention. And so I can leverage and make sure that we're getting and commanding as much as we can through group rate during those months. And then we have to be a little bit more flexible with a meeting planner if we're talking about earning somebody's business in a month like a summer month or maybe November or December. Does that make sense? Is it intuitive? Mm-hmm. Are there any questions? No? Somebody's going to have to ask a question or I'll go home crying. All right, this is my favorite slide, and one of the things that I get so excited when we do it right, it's a test that we do in the department from time to time to just make sure that we're on track. And so I'll help you understand how to read this. Marcus, do you remember when I came to your class a month ago and I didn't have slides, so I just drew this on the board? It wasn't as pretty. I made it prettier. I didn't know you were going to be here, but so if you look at this demand curve, and so really probably just focus on the green line that goes up. The way to read this is that this is 120 days before arrival, and this is your arrival day at day zero. So just concentrate on the green slope line, and then the dotted line is an average of our selling rate for every day in the month. I can't remember exactly what month I pulled. I did this because I knew there would be some competition in the room. And I don't want that to, you know, we're a private company. I don't have to report our earnings, and so I don't want somebody to go back and go, oh, Cosmopolitan. So if you look at that dotted line, that just shows you the average of our price at 120 days out, 115, and all the way through day zero. And so what happens is for transient, the bulk of our activity is happening kind of inside this 55 days. You can see that the slope gets a little bit steeper. And so hopefully, if you've built a little bit of a base, so for me, I say you'll always find the best deal at our hotel further out. The further out you book, you're going to get the very best deal, because if we're doing what we should be doing and doing it well, we're forecasting the demand to come. And so further out you get the best deal. deal. And then as the booking window accelerates, and you get inside that active period inside 50 days, see what happens to the average public selling rate. It is keeping up with the rate. Now we had a little dip on day 20, so I don't know what happened. Maybe a group fell out and we had to try to recover a little bit. But hopefully that average price line is kind of right in line with the booking curve. If the pricing line fell below that green bar, that means people are booking and you're not really doing anything about it, and you're not maximizing opportunity to capitalize on revenue. That camera is following me around. Is me walking making you crazy?
No, it's okay.
Does that make sense? The thing about casino, and I told you to ignore the red line, we can talk about it a little bit. We call our casino, they're our identity members, part of our membership program. They tend to book further in. And so what their slope increases and gets really steep kind of inside 35 days. The higher end gaming customers, the higher a gaming customer is in terms of their worth and kind of what they are to us, the most near term they book. So somebody actually could be on a private jet and land at an executive terminal and call their host and say, I'm here, I need my penthouse. And hopefully we have some idea that they're coming, because do you think we want to say no to that customer? No. So we forecast that demand, and we actually forecast demand by segments. And so I know even within the casino, breaking down casino as a segment, we can forecast in chunks of, call it ADW or average daily worth segment. So I know how much customers are worth to us, and I know when they book. And if we're smart about it and we're doing our job well, then we know who is left to come, and we're making sure that we're selling the rooms all the way through that booking period, knowing that those folks are coming at the last minute. And then this is just another one, and it's probably really, really intuitive. So if you look at the red bar again, group rooms, group is not heavy on the weekend. That's great. We don't really want it to be heavy on the weekend, because that's when our transient customers are coming to Las Vegas. So heavy, heavy Saturday, Friday, Saturday activity. The perfect world would be a four-night group comes in on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, leaves you with a little soft Thursday, and then you ramp back up and you're full for the weekend. Nothing earth-shattering, right? Makes sense? Yes.
Question.
Extra credit. I'll give you a t-shirt. Okay.
Well, so for the Cosmopolitan, how does the mix look like? So how does Cosmopolitan internally look like with the casino guests? What is the average percentage of the guests?
On an annual basis, 20% of all of our room nights are casino. And so in casino, we have guests, we have three segments. We dissect casino in three segments. So I'll tell you, so we call it special events. So that's when we're actually doing something like a poker tournament or a slot tournament, and we're sending you an invitation and we're inviting you to come in to a very finite number of days. And then we have a segment called direct mail, or the folks that we're putting a piece of mail in their mailbox, their identity members, and they get an offer from us. We're on a perpetual mailing cycle, so depending on your frequency and how often you come in, we always have an offer for you in hand, and so we call that's an incented type of business. We're incenting the behavior. And then we have this other category called non-incented, and really, non-incented just means we didn't do anything to incent your business. You're still known to us. It might mean that you pick up the phone and call your host and say, hey, I'm coming in. You might book your offer, book, just come online and tell us you're coming. And so we have a fair number of people that just do that. So we don't have to incent all of our business. Of course, we use that incentive channel like a lever. So in the summer, when you saw that group was down, or we had an example the last week in April, just about 4 weeks ago, we found out a 1,500 room group for four nights, huge, 8,000 total rooms canceled on us. 7 weeks out, and that is the worst news any sales department can get, and then the second person that hates it most is me, because I then have to scramble 7 weeks out to try to figure out how we go from running 98% occupancy for this whole week, the last week of April, to looking at 60% occupancy, and actually I just saw a forecast before I left here, we're back up to 92, because we've done things in the last 7 weeks to try to figure this out. Lots of things. That includes giving free rooms away to people that I wouldn't give free rooms away to most days of the year. But there's a time and a place for everyone, even the Colmans.
Or the dean of the hotel school.
Huh? Or the dean of the hotel. You want to come stay? So I would tell you, this slide is super ugly. Hopefully you don't judge me on that. But the difference between revenue management and revenue optimization. And so when I got into this business, my first job at Caesars, as Shivangi said, I was a hotel yield manager at Caesars Palace. And then we started calling it revenue management. And we're really to this idea of revenue optimization and this idea of maximizing the total contribution of the guests. And so very early on, revenue management in hotels was simply just looking at what somebody was paying for the room rate. And that's how we valued whether to accept or reject. We've got so much data at the Cosmopolitan, being open now 7 years, and if you have an identity card or you're charging to your folio, we can really have a good understanding of what that segment behavior is. So I love customers that book through us directly. They spend more healthy on property. Third-party guests, like people who book through Expedia, that's why I shouted, you should have booked direct. I mean, it just made me cringe when you said you booked through Priceline. I mean, but then you said you were rate conscious, and I was like, okay, well, that makes sense.
It was an example.
As an example. And I'm not poking fun. He's going to be like, I told you were my favorite student, and then he made fun of me. You're not upset with me, are you?
No. Okay. I just go back and train your grade.
Oh, yeah. Well, it doesn't matter now.
Yes, it does.
Really?
Grades do matter.
Okay. The grades do matter, but I have a job now. I'm good. So I would say that traditional revenue management focused just on the room piece of it, and so revenue optimization really focuses on the total share of wallet. And if your organization really hasn't made the shift on thinking about the total contribution, it's a little bit behind the curve. In my perspective. I also think, maybe the next slide I'll show it. Okay, so this is important. So revenue management is one thing. Our job is to maximize whatever we're selling, and actually a really neat thing I should talk about more. Last year, our department took on revenue managing cabana and daybed inventory. So we all have, every hotel up and down the strip has amazing pools. We got involved with the pool team, we created a forecast, and then ultimately, just good old Excel spreadsheet, created a forecast and were watching activity. We understood the type of demand that was coming through, and so we flexed the pricing for day beds and cabanas, and in just one season, we made $500,000 more than we did the year before. And so lots of what I've talked about has been very specific to the rooms, but as you saw from the earlier slides in my example just now on pool inventory, we really could do this across any piece of the business. I would really love to get my hands on our spa at the Cosmopolitan. I think there's a way that we could flex pricing midweek and weekend. We know when our therapists are at maximum capacity. We could take away the very, very most basic massage on a Saturday during those peak hours and make somebody pay a little bit more if they really wanted to come at 11 o'clock on Saturday morning. So there's ways to do that. We implement revenue management at the buffet. 3-day weekends, our buffet pricing is probably a dollar or two, maybe $3 more than it is on a weekend that just is kind of a normal weekend. Last week during March Madness, guess what? Our beer was more expensive. Makes sense. You think those guys care? guys is sexist. There were lots of girls there too. Although the male to female ratio in my building last week, fantastic. They didn't enjoy anything for me, but it was pretty fun. All right, I would say that, so there's a primary function, but then these are all the other things that exist and kind of have to be thought about during the day. So I find myself being a presenter, and not just here presenting to you tonight. I have to present to our operating committee, I have to present to my boss, I have to present to the front desk if I want to make a change in strategy. So you have to be a good communicator and be able to, not only understand the data,